all have a very particular purpose based on their background. And they're really just trying to do some research and figure out what happened in Area X. So the biggest thing, they set up a camp, and then they come across, it's not above ground very much, but they discover that it's below ground in a very deep, not exactly sure what it is. There are some disagreements about what they're calling it. The biologist, which you'll hear a little bit in the excerpt today, is very adamant that it's a tower, and just happens to be that a lot of the tower is underground. But it's huge, and it's narrow, very tall. Anyway, so the characters, all four of them actually, end up seeming untrustworthy. So that's where a lot of the mystery comes in. The narrator herself, she'll reference in the excerpt I'm going to read some spores that she came in contact with. So when they were in the tower at one point, there were plants growing on the walls, and she brushed up against it, and they released these spores, which she inhaled. And as a biologist, she knows that that could mean bad things, or maybe nothing, but she's not sure. So we don't know how much of her narration to trust, because she could have been affected by these things that she inhaled, but she's not sure. We also don't trust some of the other characters. One of them disappears, which you'll hear about in a second. And the psychologist definitely has some tricks up her sleeve that the biologist starts learning about throughout the story. So characters aren't very trustworthy. The scenery is very confusing. There's a lot that's left out. It's sort of this, like, hazy story. And I ended up liking it because of that. I wasn't sure. I remember finishing the book last year and closed it, and it was like, huh. Because you never quite understand exactly what happened. There was a line in the book that I ended up including in this summary about writing around the edges of things. And that's exactly what the story itself feels like. But the story is sort of, like, you don't quite get to the core of it. And so I wonder if the other two books, you actually get some more clarity. But with this one, it's just sort of this kind of hazy mystery. The writing is very vivid, and you'll hear that today. But I almost feel like I didn't quite ever wrap my brain exactly around what happened. So let's hear a little from the biologist. In the morning, I woke with my senses heightened, so that even the rough brown bark of the pines or the ordinary lunging swoop of a woodpecker came to me as a kind of minor revelation. The lingering fatigue from the 4-day hike to base camp had left me. Was this some side effect of the spores, or just the result of a good night's sleep? I felt so refreshed that I didn't really care. But my reverie was soon tempered by disastrous news. The anthropologist was gone, her tent empty of her personal effects. Worse, in my view, the psychologist seemed shaken, and as if she hadn't slept. She was squinting oddly, her hair more windblown than usual. I noticed dirt caked on the sides of her boots. She was favoring her right side, as if she'd been injured. "Where is the anthropologist?" the surveyor demanded, while I hung back, trying to make my own sense of it. "What have you done with the anthropologist?" was my unspoken question, which I knew was unfair. The psychologist was no different than she'd been before. That I knew the secret to her magician show did not necessarily mean she was a threat. The psychologist stepped into our rising panic with a strange assertion. "I talked to her late last night. What she saw in that structure unnerved her to the point that she did not want to continue with this expedition. She had started back to the border to await extraction. She took a partial report with her so that our superiors will know our progress." The psychologist's habit of allowing a slim smile to cross her face at inappropriate times made me want to slap her. "But she left her gear, her gun, too," the surveyor said. "She only took what she needed so we would have more, including an extra gun." "Do you think we need an extra gun?" I asked the psychologist. I was truly curious. In some ways, I found the psychologist as fascinating as the tower. Her motivations, her reasons, why not resort to hypnosis now? Perhaps even with our underlying conditioning, some things are not suggestible or fade with repetition, or she lacked the stamina for it after the events of the night before. "I don't think we know what we need," the psychologist said, "but we definitely did not need the anthropologist here if she was unable to do her job." The surveyor and I stared at the psychologist. The surveyor Mayor's arms were crossed. We had been trained to keep a close watch on our colleagues for signs of sudden mental stress or dysfunction. She was probably thinking what I was thinking. We had a choice now. We could accept the psychologist's explanation for the anthropologist's disappearance or reject it. If we rejected it, then we were saying the psychologist had lied to us and therefore also rejecting her authority at a critical time. And if we tried to follow the trail back home, hoping to catch up with the anthropologist to verify the psychologist's story, would we have the will to return to base camp afterward? We should continue with our plan, the psychologist said. We should investigate the tower. The word tower in this context felt like a blatant plea for my loyalty. Still, the surveyor wavered, as if fighting the psychologist's suggestion from the night before. This alarmed me in another way. I was not going to leave Area X before investigating the tower. This fact was ingrained in every part of me, and in that context, I could not bear to think of losing another member of the team so soon, leaving me alone with a psychologist. Not when I was unsure of her, and not when I still had no idea of the effects of my exposure to the spores. She's right, I said. We should continue with the mission. We can make do without the anthropologist. But my pointed stare to the surveyor made it clear to both of them that we would revisit the issue of the anthropologist later. The surveyor gave a surly nod and looked away. An audible sigh of either relief or exhaustion came from the psychologist. That's settled then, she said, and brushed past the surveyor to start making breakfast. The anthropologist had always made breakfast before.